We're coming up to an interview I pre-recorded with Mark Feltham, fabulous harmonica player. I won't say too much because it'll all be in the interview, basically all in the interview. Mark was with Nine Below Zero, still is with Nine Below Zero, and also with the Rory Gallagher Band, done a lot of session work as well. So I've divided it into three different parts. Part one I've titled I'm a Country Boy, and then I'll follow that with a brief music interlude with Mark playing a bit of harmonica with a Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. Part two is called Stan's Blues Band, and I'll follow that with a bit of Ghost Blues with Rory Gallagher. And then we go into part three, which I've entitled Frog Box. And that's probably about it. So this will take you through for a little while. It'll be ad-free. And please enjoy this, Riff Ruffers, as much as I did in interviewing Mark. Here we go. On the blower, all the way from the UK, I have legendary harp man from Nine Below Zero, Mark Feltham. Welcome back to 3MDR, and for the first time, harmonica Riff Raff, Mark.
Good evening. I think it's evening there. I think you told me it was 7 o'clock there, Phil. Good evening to you and your listeners. It's 10 a.m. in the morning here, just kind of woken up at a late one. We've been travelling around Europe, so I'm back for a couple of days' rest before it all kicks off again on Sunday. And I've just woken up to a lovely day here in central London. I'm just outside central London. Good evening to you, Phil, and your listeners.
And good morning back to you, mate. Now, I say back to 3MDR, as in June 2010, you appeared on Bealey's Roundabout.
I did indeed, yeah. I can remember speaking. I think it might have even been the anniversary of Rory's death. I'm not quite sure, but I remember speaking to him.
Yeah.
And I was very good friends of his family when his brother was alive, sadly passed on there. But I often speak to him, and we met each other occasionally. Yes, we had a good chat about the time of Rory Gallagher and when I was with Rory. Yeah, lovely memories.
Yeah. All right, Mark. Well, because we're harmonica riffraff and you're a damn good harmonica player, that's what we're going to basically be talking about. But let's go back to the beginning when you first started playing the instrument that fits in your pocket.
Okay, so it's an odd one, really, Phil. It's a really odd one, this. I'll tell you what it is. My grandfather on my mother's side was working as an engineer in Iraq, believe it or not. It's a right weird one, this. Mm-hmm. With me. And he was a professional engineer, roads and bridges and construction of and pipelines and things of that sort. Now, I'm going back now to 1920s, 1930s. And, of course, in those days, there was no air transport. And he lived in a little place about 40 miles east of London called Southend-on-Sea. And in those days, you used to commute from the Thames, River Thames estuary. The Thames is the river that runs through central London. And you used to go on the ships, merchant seamen ships, mm-hmm. down to the Far East, Middle East, and across to Oz. And all that was done from central London before the advent of air travel. And those that were obviously travelling by air in those days were wealthy people anyway, not for the general workers. So he used to go down on the merchant ships and do his work down there on the pipelines and such like. And, of course, it was a fairly long crossing in those days, and a lot of the merchant seamen used to take harmonicas with them. And when he come back from work, and I was sent down to Southend quite often, because my mum and dad had to work in central London, we were very working class family, and I was sent to my nan and granddad. Granddad would come in with his harmonicas, these tremolo tune things, and chromatics, actually, that he picked up on the trip down to Iraq. And he'd give them to me at the age of six. So that's my first introduction to the harmonica, at the age of six.
Yeah.
And that's how it started, Phil. It quite simply is an odd one, but that's how it started.
Yeah, that's great. A great story. And you came back to it. Was there a Nashville connection or something that I was reading?
A lot of my... when I picked it up seriously at the age of about 12 to 15, I desperately wanted to play country music, really. I mean, country music's my big thing. I'm a massive fan of country musicians. I love country players. And I wouldn't really class myself as a blues player. However, in London at that time, during the punk era, it was pretty difficult to find, as a growing lad in London, it was pretty difficult to find a country band that would do the circuit. And the ones that did do the circuit all had regular day jobs. And I'd left my day job working for the telecoms company to concentrate full-time on trying to get a career out of this. And it was difficult. So I found out through a BBC program, a theme tune for a BBC program called Stone Fox Chase, that was played by Charlie McCoy, and it was a bunch of Nashville session musicians in Cinderella Studios out in Nashville, and I just had to find more about this guy out because I loved what he did, and they subsequently used it on a big TV show called the Old Grey Whistle Test here that showcased new rock and blues talent all from all over the world, and it was a pioneer program. And but the theme tune they used was this harmonica thing, and I thought, I've got to find this. This is great. And it was country but with a blues tinge. And it was actually written by Kenny Buttrey and Charlie McCoy. Kenny Buttrey, you know, with Neil Young's drummer, you know.
Yeah.
So I came in through the Nashville thing, and I ordered all of McCoy's stuff. From in those days, we had no internet, obviously, so I had to order for an import shop in Aberdeen, as I remember, in Scotland. So it's a long-winded old process of waiting 6 weeks to get your records to come over, which were all vinyl, of course, in them days. No computers, no CDs, nothing. So yeah. Everything came in on vinyl from the States via Aberdeen. And the whole of my studying and learning was through McCoy and Charlie McCoy and the country stuff, and I just loved the way that he played and his attention to details and what he could do with a single note that many tried to do, you know, and got nowhere near. So all my early learning was through straight melody and country music.
Interesting. I've got a friend here, Steve Williams, who was a saxophone player, harmonica player for the John Farnham Band, who you may have heard of.
Yes.
And yeah. Charlie McCoy got him in as well, and it was a song, and we actually did a workshop on it on air, and the song was Back to Indiana, and we talked about all the bends on hole 3 and hole 2 and how you had to hit each one, and it was just amazing to hear him play that, and I hadn't heard it before, and to just have that control.
Well, he did it with such so tastefully as well, and every note that he hit was absolutely spot on. Now I've always to kids learning, I was down at a teaching yesterday, that it's the most difficult instrument in the world to play well, but the easiest to play very badly. Because the kids can pick it up and puff and blow. But when you listen to someone McCoy just playing a straight melody, something like Amazing Grace, holding those bends, and he was my man of that time. I mean, since then, there's been other great players come into my life when I discovered the blues, and other players began to come into my listening. But I have to be honest and say to you that all my early learning was through country music and playing straight melodies.
I'm going to jump ahead sort of on the plan I had here, but did you find that the fact that you learnt the country style of playing helped you as a session musician with all the work you did and sort of playing in a pop setting as well?
Absolutely. You're absolutely spot on, Phil. Absolutely spot on. Because I don't think I would have got away with the stuff that I subsequently done over the years by being a blues player. Right. I would have never have gotten away with it. And to be honest, I've seen some fine blues players in London, and you say to them, okay, play me Amazing Grace, play me a melody, play me a country melody, and they haven't got a clue. Don't know where to. I've seen all these great tongue blockers, I've seen all these great overblowers, can't play a straight melody with straight bends in it, and can't do it. So it is something that is was in me when I started, and I thank the country. I mean, I've had to do orchestral bits in London with the London Philharmonic and things like that, where if I hadn't have had the country training, I would have never have got away with it, never. I mean, it was only through meeting the guitarist that I'm with now, that I've been with 37, 38 years. It was only through him and saying, come on, I can't play this country music stuff. If we're going to try and get a record deal with the band that I'm with now, 9 Below Zero, I'm down about 78, 79 now.
Yep.
I said, you know, what else have you got in your repertoire? And of course, at that time, I had John Lee, Funny Boy Williamson, the first, who was my mentor, and Snooky Pryor and Sonny Terry were people that I'd got into at that time. And he was, Dennis, my guitarist, was very much punk mod blues and aggressive, and I'm saying, well, I'll back up. And to this day, we're like this. So I'm pulling him back and saying, listen to this, you know, calm down. It's not Crash Band Rock, you know, give it some time, listen. So that's how I eventually ended up getting a living out of what I'm doing, by being with a band that was signed up, call it punk blues, if you will, Phil.
Yeah.
Which we were at the time. But I had all that country training with me, so I was able to put a different slant on 1970s London harmonica playing. And, you know, there weren't many of us around. There's a few more around now, but none that I can think that has that country background, because it's just not hip here, not hip at all.
Below Zero. You started out as Stan's Blues Band, is that correct?
We did. We started out as Stan's Blues Band because Dennis was a fan of Stan Webb.
Right.
Stan Webb's Chicken Shack.
Mm-hmm.
Dennis was very much into the English R&B. He liked Wilco Johnson very much. He was a huge fan of Wilco, huge fan of John Mayall and the Blues Breakers, Peter Green, you know, I mean, who's
yeah.
not a fan of Greeny? He was master.
Yeah.
Everything that he did, but that's another story. But Dennis come up from that British thing, and I come up from the American thing. So he had that edge to him, and he still loves all that British R&B now. John, a huge John Mayall fan, whereas I'd be a John Mayer fan. it's totally different. We're like chalk and cheese, somehow it works. I mean, we argue and fight like two old grandmothers, you know. We got signed eventually by A&M Records, and in those days, A&M Records had just signed the Carpenters, the Police, And we were real new boys on the label. But in those days, you know, you were signed up to record label, they stood by you for 5 years. Nowadays, you can't even get a record deal, you know. We're independent now. It's the only way to get our records done. But we were the new boys on the label, and all of a sudden, you know, we were up against the Carpenters and XTC and the Police and Joan Armour Trading, and there was this rough and ready blues band from London playing on this big label. And that's what enabled us to take it out to Europe. And even now, we've still got a good following in Europe, only due to that initial record deal that we had with A&M Records back in 79, Phil. I think it was around about 79.
Yeah, and it's interesting because you became famous, or should I say infamous, for your role on the first episode of The Young Ones when you played 11 plus 11, which I would say that was sort of a new wave punk sort of style tune, yet you'd sort of done blues standards before that, so...
Absolutely. Well, what happened was that we was under pressure from the record company to write fresh material. And we'd gone from John Mayall, Peter Green, Savoy Brown stuff, all of a sudden to writing our own stuff. And because Dennis had that punk street type of music in him being a North London boy, I was a South London boy. That's another story. For North of the Thames, South of the Thames, Chilka Cheese again. He had that aggression, that, you know, that neck, all the veins in the neck coming out, where I was much more laid back. And the third album, Third Degree, was completely self-penned. A lot of the second album was as well. And we got a call via the people at A&M Records that we were signed to say, look, there's a pilot show. We think it might be good for you to do. It's starring Aid Edmondson and Rick Mayall and that. Yep. But it's only a pilot show. Nothing will ever come of it. So we goes off there and does the pilot show. And, of course, the rest is history. And it amazes me how many people, I saw you on The Young Ones, saw you on The Young Ones. And I get embarrassed every time I see that, to be honest. Yeah. So I just tell them, it's the old ones now.
You're just there playing in the lounge room.
Yeah. It's just bizarre how it all come about. As I say, it was only a pilot show. And as far as we knew, it was going to be just stuck in the archive and never used.
In 1982, after 5 years with Nine Below Zero, you left to do session work, and then you spent over 10 years with the great Irish guitarist Rory Gallagher. I'd like to know how you hooked up with him, how that came about.
Well, I'll tell you how I hooked up with him. We had a very, very kind of famous pub that was just under the radar of being an auditorium. It was not much money to get in those days, and it was a great showcase for young bands, and the pub was called The Bridge House.
Okay.
And it was dead in the centre of London, just to the east of London, in the old east end of London. It's now been all redeveloped. I went over there the other day, Phil, drove over there, and I couldn't tell you where the old pub was. It's just so vastly been all knocked down, and there's all this money over there in our apartments, and you know the story, I'm sure that's the same in all your big cities, but... It was a fabulous place for a lot of bands come out of there. Depeche Mode, they all started their careers there. You know, not necessarily blues bands, but everything across the board. A great governor in there, a guy called Terry Murphy, that was a boxing champion at the times of the craze, and it had a fantastic history. The place, you know. Anyway, a long story short, I made good friends by going over there and looking, seeing the bands with Jerry McAvoy and Brendan O'Neill. That was Rory's rhythm section at the time. And I used to stand in and get up and jam with him in Jerry's band. Jerry had a band at the time. And he used to say, come on, why don't you get up with us? Get up with us. How's the band going? I said, well, unfortunately, we've folded now. And we'd done more or less 5 years with A&M Records. And we'd all got in each other's nerves and kind of imploded, you know. So I was a free hand. So I was started picking up bits of session work, TV, film, jingles mostly. And I'd go up to London every day on the train, do two or three radio jingles into central London, come back. It was only 19 minutes on the train. So I could have... At one time, I was doing four, five, six sessions a day in central London. And being London, I don't know if you know it here, Phil, but you could walk with a bag of harmonicas in between the studios. And one day, I'd do Dodge trucks. The next day, I'd do Chevrolet. And it was good. It was good. This is before kids students had the technology to make records of their own indoors on the computer. We had studios, and they were all working studios. Coffee was going around, biscuits. It was all busy, buzzing, buzzing. Sadly, now that's all gone. But I spoke to Jerry and Brendy. So Jerry said, come up and jam with us. You know, so I got up with the Jerry McAvoy jam. Brendan O'Neill was the drummer, either him or Ted McKenna, who was subsequently with Alec Harvey. I used to jam with them, and they used to come over on a Friday, come and have a jam, come and don't be stuck in the studio. Anyway, one particular day, Jerry rang me, and he said, we're having a jam with Rory up at Nomis in London. Nomis was signed to Maybe Bell Studios in central West London. Come up and have a jam. Rory wants to meet you, you know. So anyway, I goes up there, meets Rory, who was an absolute angel of a man. And I said, on many interviews, angel of a human being, made me feel very, very at ease. And he said, come and have a jam. And of course, I wasn't used to playing at that volume level as well. I could no longer get away with just a little 15 or 20 watt amp, you know. I had to step up to a Fender Twin Reverb, so, because it was fearfully loud. And for a three piece, they made one hell of a racket, you know. And it was aggressive rock blues that I wasn't used to. But in saying that, Rory had a beautiful touch with him. He could play country fantastic. He had everything. He was a very gifted musician, acoustically as well. Mm. And a gifted man, a gifted human being. So he said to me, listen, I've got a show out at, I'll never forget it, Pistoia Blues Festival, which in Europe is one of the biggest. It's like your Byron Bay, I think, Phil. It's a massive festival just outside Pisa, I think, in Italy. And we were opening for Jimmy Page and Ginger Baker, and I had the misfortune of sitting on Ginger Baker's drum cuts. And he went absolutely mad with me and really got nasty with me, you know. He could be a bit prickly at the best of times. Jimmy was fine. Jimmy Page was laughing about it, but Ginger Baker was a bit prickly, to say the least. And I may not forget that, you know, get off my gear. This is my gear. So it was a nervous initiation for me. And then I made the mistake, of course, of walking too far forward on the first solo with Rory in this big Pistoia Blues Festival, 15,000 people there. He gave me a solo on I Wonder Who, and then walked too far forward. And then Jerry just told me afterwards, you know, make sure you keep watching Rory's shoulders. Never cross the barrier too far forward. Keep your eyes at all time on Rory's back. So that was my initiation, because in 9 Below Zero, we were all the same. We could all move forward, take solos, come back, and, you know, I was giving to the public. The public could come and see you. But with Rory, it was very much Rory and his band, very carefully worded. You know, it wasn't the Rory Gallagher band, it was Rory Gallagher and his band. And we were very much made aware of that. It was a kind of thing you didn't talk about, but a respect he had. And after that first time, where Jerry said to me, keep your eyes on his back, you know, because possibly down to Rory's crisis of confidence as well, you know. And it was a great lesson, stagecraft lesson, that I learned to always, you know, bide your time, keep back, because the boss is the boss, don't crowd his space, and less is more. And that's how it's always been. So, I did that festival with Rory, and Rory said, you know, can you do some more? Would you like to do some more for you? And I did that summer, and then I did the next 11 summers. Until he died, unfortunately. So I was with him for 11 years, and they were 11 wonderful years with probably the most wonderful man in rock music that I've ever met. I doubt I'll meet anyone as nice as him again anyway. He's an absolute darling, lovely man.
Yeah, that's fantastic. You recorded on a couple of albums that I know of anyway, the Defender in 87 and Fresh Evidence in 1990, and I do love Ghost Blues.
Ghost Blues. Do you know, I can remember being in the studio that night, and I think it was recorded down in West London somewhere. They'd all been in the pub, and Rory had this idea of kicking around. They'd all been in the pub. I'd come down late, because I was often called. I'd get a call from his office and say, look, can you be in West London in 10 minutes, you know, and I'm like an hour away. Okay, up a dash, you know, because Rory was famous for this, even turning up at Heathrow Airport to go abroad. You'd still be waiting there with like 35, 40 minutes left for the flight, and he still had to clear customs. It was always the same nightmare, because he couldn't make his mind up about it. this was one of the occasions with Ghost Blues where he couldn't make his mind up about how the track was running and how it was going. So he'd had a drink, and he got the office to call me. He'd had a drink in the afternoon after rehearsals, done in the recording studio, said, can you get down here and play a bit of harmonica on this? And when I got in, I can remember there was a few candles lit in the state, there was beers everywhere, because Rory was fond of, unfortunately, of the liquor. But there was some vibe about that track. It was a fantastic vibe. And that was one of his great, great tracks, that. I mean, people know him for all the earlier stuff, but there's some gems on that later stuff and all. And that quite rightly, Phil, was one of his gems afterward, anyway.
Yeah. He died way too young. You were at his bedside, and was it his brother that asked you to play the harmonica because it might help bring him around?
Exactly, yeah. I mean, it was a very sad time. He went into, I think, Cromwell Hospital in London to have a liver transplant. And as you know, when you lose a major organ like that, it's the side effects of everything else. Your immune system is depleted. And he was tired of touring, tired of working. His immune system was low after the major organ transplant, and subsequently, you know, got an infection. Mm-hmm. So he dipped into a coma. By this time, he was transferred to King's College Hospital in London. At once, it was on the south side, my side of London. Donald, the manager, and Tom, his faithful road manager that had been with him ever since, and he's still in the office to this very day, were called in to sit around him and to talk to him, to try and talk to him, although he was in a kind of coma. So Donald said to me, why don't you go up there and take the harmonica up and just sit there and play? And of course, I would have done anything for him. I loved him. Adored him. I was ever so upset when he died. But to cut a long story short, I took some harmonicas up and I went in on my own. And he was sitting there and I never forget it, because they put little things over his eyes to stop his eyes getting very dry, because his eyes were open.
Mm.
And he's kind of looking at me, and I was playing for him. But although there was nothing, the lights were on, but there was no one in.
No one home.
And I played some country stuff, some blues stuff. I played some Dylan. He was a huge, huge, huge Bob Dylan fan, huge Bob, and Martin Carver and people like that. People that you wouldn't think where his influences from come. Irish show bands and people like that, he loved them. Huge George Jones fan. So I played country music because I know that he loved that country blues stuff. And I played it, and then Donald would call me and say, hey, to get on. I said, well, I thought I saw a flicker from him, you know, but I don't know. And then I tried that for 2 or 3 days, come home, and then Donald said, listen, I need to get up there fairly quickly. The consultant has told me he don't think he'll see the player. So I flew up, and I was one of the people around the bedside when he died. And not all of us were allowed to be there, because by this time, Jerry had left the band and Brendy had left. But I stayed. And that was the sad end of Zori. And they just, you know, the rest is quite well known to everybody. He sadly passed away. To this day, I don't think I'll ever work with him. I mean, we all know how good he was, but I think more importantly than that is how good he was as a man.
Yeah.
I never heard him swear once. He swore. He wasn't crude. He wasn't rude. When women come backstage, the most unlikely rockstar you've ever met. Mm. Wonderful human being. Gentleman. Absolute gentleman.
you've done session harp for names such as Roger Daltrey, Paul Young, Manfred Mann's Earth Band, Joan Armatrading, yeah. New Model Army, Roachford, Annie Lennox, Joe Cocker, Oasis, and that's just to name a few. There are two in particular that I want to talk about. One is Box of Frogs, back where I started, because I remember it was early in my teaching career and one of the other phys ed teachers said, you really like this album. And it was that first album, and I particularly liked that track. That was Yardbirds as well, members of the Yardbirds. So how did that come about?
Well, the Yardbirds thing came about when I got a call from Jim McCarthy, the drummer of the Yardbirds, and said, listen, I'd like you to come down. We're getting Rory down to play on the track. We're getting Jeff Beck down to play on the track down in Surrey, one of the counties south of London. Come down and we've got a couple of tracks here. John Fiddler's written a couple of tracks. He was the con vocalist that ended up being the vocalist for the band. Paul Samuel-Smith producing. So I goes down there and they pull this one track up. I play on this track. I think Rory's playing a bit of slide on there. Jeff Beck's playing lead on it. I met Beck for the first time and the only time. And I haven't never met him since, and he only lives 10 miles down the road from me. Met Jeff Beck playing on that one, and which was lovely. Rory was in there. We were all in there doing that stuff. Finished that track. I left it, thought no more of it, and then I get a call from Paul Samuel-Smith and said, we're doing a marquee reunion. Could you front the Yardbirds for us? And I thought, yeah. I said, barely do backing vocals as it is without taking over lead vocals. Anyway, I thought, well, sink or swim. You either learn the set and do it, or you don't do it. So we did the marquee. I learned all the songs, kind of fronting it, although I'm not a front man. I don't profess to be a front man. I'm just an harmonica player that does BBs. I love singing, but I'm not a front man. That's it. I'm out in itself. But I had to do it there. So we did that, took it over to Spain, did a couple of shows over there, and as quickly as it got on its feet, it was gone again. And that was it. So that one was gone. Hmm. And but I stayed friends with Jim, and he subsequently, in later years, asked me if I was available to do some more Yardbirds shows. But by that time, I'd got back with 9 Below Zero again, who had a second career, just bubbling. And I went back with 9 Below Zero, and I couldn't do it. So someone else replaced me, actually. Alan Glenn, I think, went in there, and then Billy Boy McSkimmon went in there. So they've had a succession of frontmen. Or singers since I did it, and I've never worked with them since.
But you did Box of Frogs in 1984.
Well, you'd know the dates better than I. I remember it being a great track. I love that track.
It's a ripper.
It's got a nice vibe and very, very Yardbirds-y at the front of it. And I had a lot of time for John Fiddler as well. I like John Fiddler's ideas, and it was a nice big production on that as well, as I remember. Done in a very expensive studio, as I remember as well. But my memory's not too great, Phil, so don't pin me down on what type of time it was or when it was or what I used. Can't remember.
I'm going to give you another one here. And I quite like this band because this is a bit perhaps left field. Deacon Blue, a Scottish band. And in 1989, they had an album out called When the World Knows Your Name. And they had a really big single, Real Gone Kid, which did really well out here. And the fourth single was Love and Regret. And I think it got to number 28 on the charts.
That's correct.
Yeah. And so you played a bit of harp on that?
I played a bit of harp on Deacon Blue. I was a massive fan of Ricky Ross. I think he was a real talent. And they had their time. And as big as they were here, they disappeared as quickly as they came up. I also did a couple of Hammersmith Odeon shows with them in London. They asked me to guest. I can remember being backstage and Ricky Ross said to me, listen, I want you to come in. He said, what do you know about Fred Astaire's dancing? So I said, excuse me. So he said, well, I'd like you to come out on stage, do a few steps like this. And he was choreographing a dance routine to me. And I said, Ricky, as quickly as that came into my life, Deacon Blue, that disappeared as well. But I've got a lot of time for Deacon Blue, a lot of time for him.
All right, mate, let's get back with you and Dennis and 9 Below Zero. So you're back together again. You've been back together for a while.
For 16 years now, 17 years I've been back.
And you performed at Glastonbury this year?
Yeah, we did Glastonbury this year. Yep, we did Glastonbury, and I think we just finished. I'm actually looking at the cover of the album now. I took delivery of the new record 2 days ago, and it's sitting here on my coffee table. I'm looking at it now. No one's heard it yet because it's not gone out to the punters yet. It's going to be available from the 1st of September. I've got a copy here, and I'm going to win that out to your people out there.
Excellent. Now, hang on, mate. I'm just trying to visualise from here. I've got an idea that it could be called. It's got blue in it. It's got the you like numbers, so it's got 13 in it. 13 shades of blue.
13 shades of blue, yeah. Well, it's taken a year to make, and I'll tell you what happened. We had some interest from one of the archive guys up at Universal Music, and he said, why don't you try and get yourself a selection of great, great tunes? If at all possible, we'll research them. And this guy is a magnificent researcher. I mean, what he doesn't know about old music is just... So he said, I'll tell you what. He said, I'll present you with a batch of 30 or 40 songs, of great songs that I thought were great songs, but for one reason or another, just slipped underneath the radar. Why don't you go and re-record them? Because no one will know them anyway. I said, Denzel, what do you think about this idea? He said, well, let's do a bunch of 25 and whittle them down to... So 13 or 14. So we went out and we got this batch of songs. We made our mind up what we were going to record. And we've always wanted to put a big band on record, so we employed a brass section.
Mm.
They're the section that's on the album. We've got, it's a 9-piece on the album, which we've now got to take out to enable to play the new stuff live for the tour around Europe. We've also got to take the 9 players out with us. But the problem started kicking in when we started to record it, because I didn't think the sound was absolutely right in Glenn's studio. Glenn Tilbrook from Squeeze. It's Squeeze's studio that we... Glenn's a very good friend of ours and a great mentor as well. He's a lovely guy. So he said, well, use my studio and you can make the album. So it was convenient for us because it's very close to us all. Now, that may or may not have been a good decision. We recorded some Come Away. Dennis said, what do you think about this one? We went, oh, I don't know, I think we could do with a bit more bottom end on that. Let's remix this one. And of course, it got into that Manfred Mann syndrome where you end up doing 100 mixes of the same song. And in the end, we just said, right, we're disappearing up on our own backside here. Let's look at it all again, stripped it down, took it back to basics, recorded it in analogue, and it sounds fantastic. We've got a brand new record, and I think it's about our 19th album. There's lots of stuff out there, and it's in my hand, and it's coming out at the end of the month. But I should get you a copy over.
That'd be excellent.
So it's a few songs that never really was that very popular in the first place, because they might have been B-sides, they might have been extra tracks, but ones that we've given a little bit of new life to. And that's the story of 13 Shades of Bluefield. Covered the Toddle on it by Little Walter, I've always wanted to record. It was one of Little Walter's instrumentals. There's a good atmosphere, and I think we've done a credible job on it. I've always said to Dennis, listen to this. This is one of his lesser-known ones, the Toddle. So I played that. But I used Fender Champ all the way through that album with two microphones for anyone technically wanting to know how we did it. And I had a mic on the back of the speaker and a mic on the front of the speaker. But it was a Fender Champ, and I used the Shure 545 SV into the Champ, for those that technically...
Yeah, and there's listeners out there that appreciate that, yeah.
Very simple.
We might wind up here, Mark, from 3MDR and Harmonica Riff Raff. Thanks for your time today and your fabulous harp playing over the years.
Well, thank you very much for listening, and thank you very much... For allowing me into your world out there. It's a world that I'd love to come over and play. I have great memories about being over there with Rory. We did a flash, it was all gone, 5 shows, and I never came back. And as quickly as it happened, we were over to Los Angeles starting the American, North American tour. And I've never been back since. I remember drinking in the bar of the Siebel Townhouse in Sydney and thinking, this is it, I've arrived, you know. And as soon as it was there, it was taken away again. And I've never been back, but I'd love to come back. Would love to come back. So thank you for listening to my humble story, Phil. Thank you.
And thanks, Billy, for setting up that interview with Mark Feltham. What a job I've got here when you can talk to these people. And thanks to Pete and thanks to Mark for all the great feedback. And, yeah, we look forward to the CD, and certainly we'll get some airtime here on Harmonica Riff Raff, which is your Wednesday Drive Time Harmonica show. And we're live off the mast on 97.1 FM. And we're streaming live around the globe on 3MDR.com. And to all you people who are listening in the UK or in Ireland, wherever you are, hope you enjoyed that interview with Mark Feltham. So part one was I'm a Country Boy, and then we broke that up with Mark playing harmonica on Nights in White Satin with the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. Part two was Stan's Blues Band, and then we followed that with Ghost Blues. Well, part of, I didn't play at all, Rory Gallagher. And then part three was Frog Box. And we closed that out with Back Where I Started by Box of Frogs. Now, this is Cafe Espresso. That is one with and one without. And I thought we might as well have Mark Feltham. Why not? And with the band Nazareth. And they're a Scottish band as well. And most of you might be aware of Love Hurts, a big hit they had in 1975, I think. I've got here from the album Hair of the Dog. But Mark also did a track with them off their Snakes and Ladders album, which came out in 1989, called Lady Luck. So Cafe Espresso, Nazareth, we'll start off with the one with, and then we'll have the one without. Here we go.
She was born, but that was Friday, baby. By Sunday she was gone. So I drove on down to Texas, where I did not do too well. I fell hard for this woman, child. Turns out she came from well. Lady Luck, help me hold on. Lady Luck, help me hold on. To one that I love. Well, I had no luck with women. Thought I'd try my hand. So I headed for Nevada, gonna really take them on. But the way the hands were falling and the way the money goes, you could say it's getting colder. You could say I nearly froze. Lady Luck, help me hold on. Lady Luck, help me hold on. Souvenirs don't remind me where they're from.